Well, thank you. Good afternoon. And I would like to start by thanking Philip, Jamie, and Mark for inviting me as well and my colleagues here to talk to you today about this thing, the approach to modeling Roman roads in the northwestern Iberian Peninsula. And the structure of my speech today will be as follows. I will begin with a very short introduction about the objectives of this work. Then I will present very briefly the case study to you, the northwestern Iberian Peninsula in the Roman period. Then I will move to some methodological notes about the calculation of movement costs. And finally, I will focus on the case study itself, on this postdictive approximation to the Roman roads in this area within two consecutive stages. First, a large scale approach, and then a more detailed analysis that is very much a work in progress yet. So, well, most of the things that I could say to introduce this piece of work here have already been said by Philip in his keynote speech today, so I don't feel I have to stress the importance of the analysis of movement in ancient contexts, nor the contributions that digital tools have been doing in the last years to this field of research. So I will skip this, basically. And within the possible approaches to model ancient routes in using digital tools, I would like to make a distinction between these two concepts here, between one type of approaches that could be described as reconstructive or predictive, that try basically to reconstruct or recreate the lost portions of ancient routes by using the preserved remains. And as opposed or as complementary to this, I would like to stress today in what I have called here an analytical or postdictive approach that in its turn tried rather to understand the rationale behind the known parts or the preserved remains of the ancient routes rather than recreate or reconstruct the lost portions of those routes. So this is what I will be basically speaking about today. And the case study for this approach will be to analyze and to try to understand the Roman roads in the northwestern Iberian Peninsula. We are talking, well, this is a very simple and a schematic map taken from the Wikipedia, but it's a very good one, I think. This is more or less the structure of Hispania in a little after the turn of the century, when the conquest of Spain by the Roman army had already finished. And we will focus in this area here, which is basically the northern part of the modern-day Portugal and the northwestern part of the modern-day Spain. That around the year 100 AD, when all of the major towns and secondary towns of there had already been constructed and developed, and most of the roads are functioning already in this area, would have more or less this appearance. We have three main towns, three capital towns of the so-called Conventus Juridicus, Lucus Augusti, Asturica Augusta, and Bracara Augusta. The three of them founded in the period of August, as the name implies. And then we have a network of roads, of which this that you can see here would be the principal, the most important ones, and a number of secondary towns of different character and importance that most of them, as you can see here, are distributed along these roads, these main roads. This map is based on quite substantial archaeological evidence that is summarized here, and basically related to the routes of the roads, we have a lot of information coming from the discovery of a large number of milestones that in most cases really don't leave a lot of room for imagination as to where the routes went by, right? We have especially a very high concentration of milestones towards the southern part of what is today Galicia and the north of Portugal, and a much lower number of them towards the north. Based on this substantial amount of evidence, some colleagues for decades now have been trying to reconstruct the routes of the roads by using what we call describe as a joining the dots approach, and basically using this large amount of milestones as the main dots to be joined, together with the principal and secondary towns, and well, just drawing more or less straight lines that connect these dots. This is an example of one of the most complete reconstructions of the road network that was done in 2004. Sometimes, as I said, you don't need a lot of imagination. Some other times you need much more imagination, like in the north there. Well, as you can see, the reconstruction is rather rough and really not very organic. So it's basically straight lines connecting some of these points. We will focus basically in the most important routes, and among those, which would be this one here, on those routes that have more direct remains of their past route, so to say. And the objectives of our work were, as I said at the beginning, to try to understand this layout of the routes and to try to understand why the roads follow those rather likely routes that we can see today. So these were the two main questions that we were asking at the beginning of our research. And as I said, we will focus on the routes with more direct evidence. Well, this is just a summary of some of the publications that were produced during this more or less long research line here. It all started with a master thesis in 2009, and then, well, we have been coming back to this issue, trying to refine the analysis and to improve the results, as I will show today. Okay, well, following this initial distinction between predictive and analytic approaches, this case, as you have seen here, seems very well suited for an analytical approach to try to understand the layout of the routes. That, in its turn, should be, I think, at least, a basic thing to do before attempting a reconstruction instead of just joining these dots with straight lines. Well, some methodological notes that I will go very briefly over them, because most of these things have already been discussed here before, that relate to the calculation of movement costs. The initial hypothesis for our approach is the one that you can see this slide here, that in the absence of any other criteria, roads are designed to follow the route that requires the least effort in terms of movement. And precisely those other criteria is what we want to unveil. Okay, so we followed an analytical sequence based on the proposition of a series of hypotheses from the simpler to the more complex, starting with this very basic idea that roads are intended to join places. And there are three key concepts in our analysis: the concept of nodes, of cost factors, and of positive evidence. Nodes are those places linked by the roads, and we can distinguish between primary nodes that are the starting, crossing, or arrival points that are to be linked by a road, and then the secondary nodes that are those places that become linked by a pre-existing road. So it's like a temporal distinction between the primary nodes that pre-exist to a road and the secondary nodes that emerge after the road is functioning. Then the concept of cost factors that has been already discussed here, those geographical elements that affect movement and that allow us the calculation of this very well-known idea of the least cost paths. And then the concept of positive evidence, which are the remains of the original routes of the roads, basically the milestones that you have seen in the slide before, and also the reconstructive proposals that can be used somehow as some positive evidence of the likely route of these roads. So the sequence of analysis we follow, it's very simple, it's methodologically nothing especially sophisticated. We first choose some primary nodes as a starting or arrival points, and choose some cost factors, some geographical factors that constitute impedances for movement. We combine them and predict least cost routes. And we kind of ground truth these cost routes with the positive evidence we have about the actual routes in the past. And the results of this ground truthing allow us to refine the inputs in order to improve the matching between the least cost paths and the ground truthing. And the refinement of the inputs would consist either in the selection of new primary nodes or in the selection of new cost factors, or of in both things at the same time sometimes. So in methodological terms, we had to face a number of decisions as to which cost factors would be selected for the analysis, which geographical elements would have affected movement in this time and in this particular region. Then the selection of some cost functions to quantify how those elements, those factors affect movement, and then the selection of data sets. So this might have implications in terms of scale and accuracy. In terms of the selection of cost factors, and following this idea of going from the simpler to the more complex, we initially relied in what can be considered as the most universal factor affecting movement in most geographical areas, which is terrain gradient or slope. Right. So this was our initial cost factor, the only one that we choose at the beginning, and only with the addition of an extra cost factor to the river courses to avoid the effect of some least cost paths following the exact beds of some of the rivers. Then once we decided that we were going to use slope as the initial cost factor here, we had to select a cost function to quantify how much slope affects movement. And among the different options we had here, we followed a pragmatical approach and we selected the one that best fits our purpose. So the one that best matches the particular geographical conditions of this region. To do that, we selected a small section of the area where we had a special good knowledge of the route of the ancient roads, and we tested in this area the calculation of different least cost paths using different functions. Basically, the functions proposed by Irmela Herzog after the work of Minetti and colleagues, the function by Pandolf, the function proposed by Jovera and Slukin, and the function proposed by Waldo Tobler. So we compare the results of these different least cost paths with the known evidence here, and we could see that the function that best matched our particular case was that of by Jovera and Slukin, that on the other hand is based on quite a solid and robust series of empirical evidence. And we also decided to use a Tobler function basically as a term of comparison, and because this function has been widely used in archaeology in the last years, so we wanted also to check how good was it in compared with the one of by Jovera and Slukin. So this is a measure of the similarity between the coast paths and the proposed reconstruction of the route in the table at the bottom, and at the top you have a measure of the proximity of the different least cost paths with the known milestones in this particular section here. Okay. And in terms of the selection of data sets, our initial choice was to use the Shuttle Radar Topography Mission digital elevation model that has already been mentioned here before. And in terms of, this is a rather coarse digital elevation model with a resolution of approximately 80 meters. But, it was quite suitable in terms of scale because we are going to analyze a very large area. But we wanted to be sure that in terms of accuracy for this particular area, this data set was not especially wrong or didn't contain a lot of errors. So we compared the performance of this digital elevation model with a national 10-meter digital elevation model here, and we calculated again least cost paths using both digital elevation models and using different cost factors again. So this was a very iterative process, but in general terms, I will show you here some examples. There's a rather good matching between the results produced by the two digital elevation models. So we had a reasonable security that this model was well suited for our analysis here. So we can move now into the results of the work of our research. And I will start by presenting this first large scale approach. That is something that we already published in 2015. And by going back to this general view of the area in the by the end of the first century AD, our first hypothesis here was, as I said, the most basic and most obvious, so to speak, that the regional capitals were the only primary nodes for the development of this road network, and that the roads were designed only to join these three capitals, just with the no regard for any other consideration, factor, node, or whatever. So if that is correct, it should be expected that the roads follow the simplest route to join these three places. And of course, these coast paths are a useful tool to explore this idea. Well, what we did was to calculate the least code path between these three capital towns and to see to what extent they matched the known evidence related to these roads. And as might be expected, this first hypothesis was not very good in general, save for this particular road here that joins straight Braca and Lucus, and that shows a pretty good match with the known evidence of milestones and bridges here. We also considered the stars represent bridges of certain or possible Roman origin. But the other two, especially this one here, the one that joins Bracara and Asturica, follows a very different route when compared to the most likely route that the milestones indicate. So we measured the coincidence here. We measured the distance between these least coast paths and the milestone, and as you can see here, there's a pretty bad matching, especially in the Bracara-Austurica road, where most of the milestones are located 3 kilometers or farther away from the least coast path. It's not that bad in this other case, but even so, it's not it's far from perfect yet. So, and again, we measured the coincidence between our coast paths and the proposed reconstruction of the two roads here. And well, again, the coincidence is pretty bad, especially for the Bracara-Austurica case. So since this was not enough to understand the layout of the roads, we introduced new concepts, new elements in our analysis, and our second hypothesis was that secondary towns or some of these secondary towns could also have been primary nodes in the network, so that in particular the towns of Iria, Brigantium, Tude and Aquae Fabriae, which are the four second degree towns in the Roman time in this region, could have also played a primary role in the design of the network. So we repeated our analysis again, but considering these nodes as primary nodes in the network. And the result improves quite substantially, especially for this particular section of the roads here between Bracara, Iria and Lucus. Well, in this case, nothing changes because there's no secondary nodes here. But in the case of this road here, between Asturica and Bracara, the inclusion of Aquae Flavia really doesn't improve things very much. This can also be quantified again. So the histogram of the distance between coast paths and milestones is, well, looks much better for the case of this road to the west next to the coast, but it doesn't change a lot very much in the road to the south and the east. So, well, again, a measure of the coincidence between least coast paths and the proposed reconstruction of the routes. We have a pretty good coincidence here of 80% within a buffer of 2 kilometers. But the rest of the figures are still very low. So in this case, in this first approach, we continued our analysis but relying basically in the introduction of new nodes rather than in the introduction of new coast factors. So we ended up with We had still some large part of the network that were far from being understood, as all this road here. We had nothing to explain this distribution of milestones here. Most of this road 17 down here, and some isolated milestones to the north. So, as I said, in this first part of our analysis, we relied very much in the introduction of more primary nodes rather than in the consideration of additional cost factors. And in the end, we arrived at this result thanks to the introduction of another primary node here, that is a bridge. This was taken from some previous work that we have been doing in other parts of this region. And since topography here is rather hilly and compartimented, we could see that the crossing points of rivers were sometimes very crucial points to structure movement across this landscape. So we took the most important Roman bridge in the region, which is the one marked with the yellow star. We introduced it as another primary node, and we got a much better match between the coast paths and the evidence of the ancient roads. So the initial results of this first phase of analysis were those that you can see summarized here, that some primary nodes existed beyond the capital towns, especially Iria Flavia and Aquae Flavia, to understand the layout of the routes, and some river forts, as this one of Ponte Vivei, this Roman bridge, had also to be part of the initial design of these routes. And it does also have some chronological implications because, well, as you can see from the names of these places, Iria Flavia and Aquae Flavia, where they had a Flavian name, so they were considered to be Flavian foundations, but we could see that they are aligned with these roads here and here, that for which we have a number of Julian and Claudian milestones that indicate us that that those roads were built in the beginning of the first century AD. So the importance of these particular points in the general landscape of the area is prior to their development as important towns in the late first century AD. And this would be the distribution of Flavian milestones that relate very much to this other particular road here. So in order to improve a little bit our understanding of this picture here, we still had a lot of portions of the network that were not explained, especially this road here, the so-called road 17 in the Antonine itinerary, that showed a very poor match between the expected route and the actual evidence of the ancient route. So I'll be finishing in a couple of minutes. We have a very detailed reconstruction of this road here compared to the other ones, thanks to some recent projects, especially this so-called Vias Augustas project that was done in the last years to try to reconstruct the actual route of this road based on extensive fieldwork. And we have also a number of milestones and other direct evidence for the route here. So, as we have seen after our previous analysis, we had a very poor match, either considering Aquae Flavia or not as a primary node. So, in this case, we thought of considering other cost factors rather than other primary nodes, since there were no more obvious nodes to consider here at this stage, at least. And this, besides that, this is a peculiar geographical area that includes the highest elevations in the northwest of the Iberian Peninsula, here, beyond 1,500 meters. That seems very clearly that the road avoids to cross this higher area here, and also this other higher area here. So we consider it higher altitude areas as another cost factor here, and we tried to explore to what extent the avoiding these higher altitude areas was again a cost factor in this area. We examined the actual elevation that the roads go across, and we saw that the threshold of 950 meters was in general the one that was not exceeded by the road, except in two particular points here, where the road goes a little higher, but not beyond the 1,050 meters. So we added a 10 times extra coast here, and we got a much better match, not perfect again, but a much better match here with the actual route of the road. But again, this was not enough. So there were still large portions unexplained. And we consider another possible extra cost factor, and is the fact that roads could have been avoiding steep slopes to favor the movement of wheeled vehicles. And it has been proposed that this slope could be, the threshold for this slope could be between 8% and 16%. So we again tested empirically the slopes that the road were following. We have here the thresholds of 8% and 16%, and the percentage of the route below those thresholds. So we included that as another part of the analysis. We added a 2 times extra cost for these slopes here, and we got again a better match, especially for this portion of the road here. But again, there were some portions unexplained, so we continue playing here with different possibilities and different extra factors conditioning the routes of the roads here. And in this particular area, we relied on the hypothesis that has been suggested that this road could have a military origin. So there's a lot of military camps here, all the squares. And we choose one of them, Petavonium, which is the most important one and the oldest one of them, and to see to what extent the location of some of these camps could also have conditioned the route of the road. And again, we added Petavonium as a new primary node, and we got a much better matching again here. So in the end, I will finish right now. I will skip the next few slides. So in the end, we finished with a matching that is pretty good. 88% of the optimal paths match the reconstructed route of the roads within a buffer of 2 kilometers, and 75% within a buffer of 1 kilometer. If we use milestones as a term of measure, we have here an accumulated frequency of distance between milestones and the coast paths here. And as you can see, within a range of 2 kilometers, we have 80% of the 87 milestones known in the area. And within a range of 6 kilometers, we have 90-something percent. You have to bear in mind that not all those milestones are really in situ today. They are probably next or close to the areas where they were originally found. So this gives a more or less approximate idea of the proximity between the original position of the milestones and the road. So just to finish a little bit ahead of time, sorry about that. My final remark would be that, well, what I told you today is a linear story that in fact is the result of an iterative analysis where we have been combining in different ways all these factors and nodes in order to find the combination that best matches the roads as we know them today. And in terms of historical knowledge, this has allowed us to get a better understanding of the rationale behind the roads, of which places were relevant a priori for the construction or the layout of the roads, of the temporality of these places, and the influence of different topographic factors in the setup of this network of roads. Sorry for being a bit too long, and thanks very much.